forgot it always. Okay, you can start.
From the beginning or?
As you want.
So I will start with review of quasi-local approach to black hole horizons. Then I will introduce adapted coordinates that will allow me to solve this problem in axisymmetric case. I will be also talking about proper boundary conditions in this problem. I will show you solution for axisymmetric near horizon geometry equations. Then I will embed this solution into Kerr and Tide Sitter spacetime. I will mention so-called doubly-extremal horizon in this case. And then I will comment on extending these results. I will start with the general idea of quasi-local approach. One of the very useful tools in general relativity is Killing horizon. It is null hypersurface with some Killing fields that is null on this hypersurface. It has many uses. In particular, it represents this black hole horizon as we understand it. For example, especially in typical black hole spacetimes, for example, in Schwarzschild, horizon is just bifurcated Killing horizon. And these horizons can be used in developing black hole thermodynamics or in some rigidity theorems. The problem with this, with Killing horizons, is that you need Killing vectors, right? So these are pretty strong conditions. So the idea of quasi-local approach is to relax the definition of Killing horizon while still keeping it strong enough to have some quantities to work with. And it described this equilibrium, most equilibrium black holes, or some black holes in isolation from the rest of the spacetime. This approach can be developed in arbitrary number of dimensions. I will restrict myself to four dimensions, with spacetime obeying vacuum Einstein equations with cosmological constant lambda equation first. So I will start with the definition of non-expanding horizon. I will call it H with some degenerate metric Q. So it is a smooth null hypersurface in spacetime with some vector L, which is tangent and also normal because it's null. Geometry forces H to be congruence of new geodesics generated by L. Well, it's a technical detail. L is defined up to multiplication, so it's really equivalence class of vectors, but it won't be relevant in my considerations. For this vector field, we can define optical scalars, including expansion, to assume be vanishing. In simple terms, you can see this quantitative picture. It's that infinitesimal area spanned between these null geodesics that is the same along geodesics. Well, of course, we can integrate this infinitesimal area to get total area of horizon, and it just means that this area stays the same, hence the name non-expanding horizon. We'll assume that vector field L satisfies dominant energy conditions. That is, vector in equation 2 is future causal. These aren't really strong. They are satisfied by reasonable. They are satisfied by reasonable physical fields. And of course, from that follows through each other equation that shear and twist will also vanish. Now, we'll assume that H is topological product of some two-dimensional closed manifold delta and R. These are these geodesics generated by L. Delta can be any closed two-dimensional manifold, so sphere, torus, two torus, and n torus. For the reasons I will explain later, I will be concerned with delta being topological sphere. Excuse me.
Przepraszam.
Okay. So I will be concentrated on sphere. Moreover, we will assume that Einstein equations are satisfied on the horizon. This definition of non-expanding horizon is nice. You can prove some things, but I will be needing something more rigid. So I will introduce isolated horizon. You have another quantity. The idea is to set geometry of this horizon to stay constant in time. Time in quotations, of course. So we'll simply assume equation 4, that is leader along L, which is our pseudo time, and covariant derivative of horizon commute. This derivative is induced by covariant derivative from spacetime. So with all that conditions, we can write covariant derivative of L on isolated horizon as being proportional to L itself in equation 5. And this equation defines so-called rotation one form. It is important quantity because it reacts to Einstein equations, really. Moreover, it can be contracted with L to give, in equation 6, I call it kappa. It is called surface gravity. In asymptotically flat spacetime, it would be just acceleration of particle on the horizon, and it plays role of temperature in black hole thermodynamics on related horizon. In particular, if it vanishes, then horizon is called extremal or degenerate. And now we can move to equation 7. So let delta be space-like section of our horizon. I will call delta either section or cut, transversal to L. Then vacuum Einstein equations with cosmological constant induce constraints on geometry of such section, namely equations seven, really, which are called near horizon three equations. This capital Latin indices indicate quantities on delta, while small were on H. I will say solve these near horizon geometry equations in axisymmetric case. Before I get to that, we can integrate this over the whole delta to get equation 8. Eta is two-dimensional form. And K is Gaussian curvature. Genus of delta, which is simply number of holes, right? So it can be shown that on delta with genus greater than zero is lambda equal to Gaussian curvature and omega vanishing. Well, this really explains why I'm concerned only with sphere, because it was because the problem was solved for other cases. Now on sphere, we have inequality 10 satisfied. Well, I will return to this fact a little bit later. Now, for axisymmetric horizon, we can introduce some nice coordinates. So I introduce theta and phi, such that symmetry by d phi. Then the metric Q of our section is given by 7. Rather simple metric. To make things a little. It is not. It is not defined uniquely, but I can define it in such a way that, that the whole area of a horizon, integral of eta, is equal to 4 pi r squared, where r is some constant, and it is the base of the radius of horizon. Metric is given by equation 13. Yes, well, it is pretty much given by this function p squared of x. So now there are two important things. Firstly, we can calculate Gaussian curvature of our horizon. And put it into that mentioned earlier, and it turns out that we get lambda r squared less or equal to 1. Obviously, our solutions satisfy this. Second important thing is that function p must admit certain nice limits on poles, which are. In our coordinates, these are x equal to plus minus 1. So we get solution 16. We get equation 16. This prevents the conical singularity of our metric. And from regularity of metric, or equivalently that or equivalently simply from assumption that is equal to p, 2 pi times infinitesimal radius plus some smaller infinity. very good. Now, next step is, well, in order to make calculations easier, we can Hodge decompose our rotation one form into potentials u and b. Well, these are some functions of x. as you can see, U is defined up to additive constant and B up to multiplicative constant. Moreover, and this will be important later, you can see that B must be positive for all x's, right? Otherwise, we would have logarithm of something negative or zero, which is very ill-behaved. Yes, so now we can substitute this Hodge decomposition and our coordinates into near horizon geometry equations. And we get three differential equations, 18, 19, and 20. And it turns out we must differentiate between two classes of solutions, namely solution for equation 19 is very simple. It is some constant tilde omega. And we must differentiate between solutions tilde omega vanishing and non-vanishing. So in the first case, when tilde omega vanishes, we get that u is constant and b is at most linear function of x. But as I mentioned, it must be positive for all x's, which forces us to take both u and b to be constants. In the second case, tilde omega non-vanishing, we can just integrate equations 18 and 19 to get solutions 23 and 24. You can see these constants B0 and U0 I've mentioned. Moreover, through integration, we introduced constant X0. And we also introduced omega, which is simply omega tilde divided by B0 squared. So we just calculated our potentials. So if we return to equation 20, we can see that it will turn out to be one equation for function P squared. So in the first case, omega tilde vanishing, as I said, potentials are constant, so our rotation one form vanishes. Integration yield P squared equal to 1 minus X squared. If you think about it, it will turn out that this is equivalent to taking lambda R squared equal to 1, or cosmological constant equal to Gaussian curvature. Well, this describes a non-rotating case, spherically symmetric case, where a metric is given by 29. Well, as you can see, this is just a sphere metric. Second case, this more complicated case, we get differential equation 30 with some constants x0 and omega, but this can be eliminated by boundary conditions we put on P squared and its derivative. And it will turn out that x0 is equal to 0 and omega squared is equal to 1 minus 1/3 lambda R squared divided by 1 minus lambda R squared. But of course, by integrating 30, we would get two more integration constant, but this can be eliminated also. So I just didn't bother to write it down. And all this leads us to, to function P squared. So effectively metric on our horizon given by 32. Yes. Now, we must assume that omega squared and p squared are positive, which leads us to inequality in 33, namely that lambda r squared is less than zero. Well, we can find potentials B and U in 34, and from that one form in 35. Yes. That is, well, pretty much solution to near horizon geometry equations in axisymmetric case. Now we can move on. Now we can move on to embedding it into Kerr anti-de Sitter metric. So again, axisymmetric spacetime with cosmological constant, right? I've written this metric in 36. Well, it is rather complicated to work with. What is important is this function delta r in 37 and at the very bottom. Vanishing of this function, of this polynomial, signifies horizon in our spacetime. Well, in this particular case, these are killing horizons. You can see this qualitative picture here, how it would look. This one is for positive lambda. Yes. So R1, R2, and R3 are horizons of our spacetime. But we are interested in extremal horizons. Well, it turns out that between these roots, metric changes from time-like to space-like. That is, you can see here you have this delta r multiplying dt squared, right? Time changes. And it turns out that a horizon is extremal if it is double root of delta r. Yes, it would look like this, more or less. So now we have to translate it. Now we have to use these conditions to translate from parametrization in Kerr-de Sitter spacetime to our parametrization. So we take this Kerr anti-de Sitter horizon, we put T equal constant and R and R equal to root of delta R. And we get equations 38, which translates P squared and R squared into Kerr-de Sitter parameterization. Now, next step, we want delta R to have multiple roots, which means calculating determinant of delta R and making it equal to zero. One can do it. For our results to be correct, one must also remember about positivity, right? We want p squared to be positive, r squared to be positive, a squared to be positive, and I've taken mass to be positive because I can't without loss of generality do it. And we get equations 39. That is square of angular momentum, divided by mass, of course. square of angular momentum and mass of Kerr-de Sitter spacetime given in our parametrization. Well, I can just put it back into metric and I will get equation 40. Yes. Now you can compare, and this is the exact metric we have calculated earlier. Yes, in this general case of near horizon geometry equation. This is the same metric. Moreover, constraints on parameters are lambda r squared recovers this non-rotating case, of course. So again, this results agree. So solution to axisymmetric near horizon geometry equation into Kerr anti-de Sitter spacetime. Now, one can also consider a triple root, yes, or doubly extremal horizon. You can see on this picture how it would more or less look. If one would have to guess, one would say that probably there's some very interesting happening here. Yes. Also, you can find when this, for what value of parameters this root is triple root. I've given these values in 32. Yes. Well, it's actually pretty funny because apparently nothing significant happens here. At least I haven't found anything rather interesting. For completeness, here are roots R1, R2, and R3 given in our parametrization. Equations are rather awful. Good. So now the last part, how one could extend results. Well, we will take four-dimensional spacetime with Einstein equations, with cosmological constant and some non-vanishing energy momentum tensor. We'll restrict ourselves, of course, to the simplest such case, that is energy momentum tensor of electromagnetic field, just free sourceless field. Well, procedure of solving this is very similar. I will allow myself to retract, to go back. Oh. Equations 18 and 19 would be unchanged. But in equation 20, we would have some additional term coming from this energy momentum tensor. But this addition can be expressed as function as can be expressed by our potentials U and B. I won't be showing this. Well, it's not very interesting, really, but we can express this addition with U and B. And it turns out that our new solution, our new p squared, is given by old p squared plus some constant. I mean, constant depending on electromagnetic field. So this is how it looks, equation 46. A can be expressed as a function of omega squared, lambda, and r squared. In 47, I've did the opposite. I've written omega squared as a function of the rest. But if you look at it attentively, you can see that if we put A equal to zero, so no field, we get our old omega squared back. Moreover, it would seem that parameters obey the very same constraints, that is lambda r squared is less or equal one. But I should finish calculations. In principle, it should be embeddable in Kerr-Newman Kerr-de Sitter spacetime, but I wasn't successful in doing so. So that's how you can extend results. And that was all. Thank you for your attention.
So thank you very much. So I think we have a lot of time for questions. So maybe someone would like to ask.
I have a question about the previous slide. So I think that if you would consider extremal Kerr-Newman solution, and then when you take near horizon limit, you obtain that also you obtain that Faraday tensor has a good limit, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I think, but perhaps I'm wrong, but I think that there is no a priori argument that it should be so. Can you somehow, but perhaps I'm wrong here, but if it's so, can you somehow describe geometries which satisfies 45 with Timmy New, which looks like energy momentum tensor of electromagnetic field, but without magnetic field? So, because a priori there could be such geometries, such spacetimes that you have extremal horizon, but which satisfies Einstein Maxwell equations, but there is no limit of Faraday tensor.
But why are you concerned about the limit? This equation, it is one of the equations, one of constraints for without taking any limits.
Mm-hmm.
Limit is just to produce a new solution to Einstein.
Yes, yes, yes. So my point, equations. Yes, yes, I understand. So my point would be, are there any solutions like that? My question would be, are there any solutions like that?
Like what?
That they satisfy something like 45, but yeah. There's no real FMNU.
I think that this limit just exists. I didn't check myself this limit for the spaces with cosmological constants. But it, at least without cosmological constant, this limit is well defined. It means that it is a limit both for metric tensor and for electromagnetic field.
Yes.
So I don't know.
I think that this fact that electromagnetic field has well defined limit is somehow it's not fundamental.
I see. So if we write, you think that if we write a general spacetime with extremal killing horizon, which also contains, which is electro vacuum, then you think there is no general argument proving that this limit exists.
I think so, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I see. Actually, it's a good question. I haven't seen this myself.
Thanks.
But at least in this case, what was discussed in the talk, those solutions were embedded in Kerr-de Sitter.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. In Kerr and anti-de Sitter, Kerr-de Sitter spacetime. So this the notion of limit was not brought up at all.
Mm-hmm. I see.
Some different subject, which maybe there is something still non-trivial in this. It's a good question. Mm-hmm. And actually, I have a question because those results containing electromagnetic field, they go a little beyond what we did in our paper. So here in 46, you say that this new P squared is old P squared plus a constant, but we have those conditions on the poles that P squared should be zero. So I'm concerned what happens to those conditions here. It means that those poles, they are shifted somehow.
It should satisfy these boundary conditions. That's how you get 48.
But if P square is zero on the... I see, but this is a new... But if P square is bigger than zero, then P square plus A, there is no chance P square plus A will vanish. Unless A is negative, but then if it is negative, then all P square may be negative. It's a suspicious question.
Maybe saying it's old P squared is a little misleading.
Okay, I understand. So it may be not necessarily a square of a real function. It is just some function which
it is given like.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I haven't written it. I thought I would. But if you'd write P squared given by omega squared, it would be the same as here, but this omega squared would be different, okay? So that would be it. So in the limit, this P squared wouldn't vanish on poles, but P squared plus A would vanish. Okay?
I see.
Yeah, so that's the thing, but it vanishes on poles, I'm sure.
I see. So it means that this old P squared is not yet selected such that it vanishes on the poles. There are still some constants of integration in it, and then you adjust those constants of integration such that together p squared plus a vanishes on the poles.
Yes, this is p squared, but given by omega squared, which was redefined in this case. But mm-hmm. yes, oh, alone it wouldn't vanish on poles.
So some maybe other questions?
Maybe I should explain why that result was so considered as interesting in the vacuum case. So in the case without cosmological constant, the black hole uniqueness theorems are not complete. And well, while physicists are actually happy with the black hole uniqueness, but mathematicians still see some gaps in proofs. And particularly extremal case is the case about which it seems that those uniqueness results break. So, and what we did here, it was I mean, in the lambda equals zero case, and also in this case, is a sort of uniqueness result. It shows that upon some assumptions, the local constraints which hold on extremal horizon don't admit other solutions than those by Kerr, and in this case, by Kerr, de Sitter, and by de Sitter. The only weakness of this is that we assumed axial symmetry, while it would be nicer to have some theorem proving that actually every solution has to be axisymmetric. Some knowledgeable people tried to prove it. I know that Khrushchev and Jacek Jezierski and some other, and Paul Todd, they were trying to prove this equation admits only axisymmetric solutions, but we don't have neither proof nor argument proving that it is otherwise. So in the case with a cosmological constant equal to zero, there is that result by Khrushchev, Todd, and Shipka, I believe, that axisymmetric solutions are isolated. It means you cannot, by adding a linear perturbation, you cannot perturb this solution to be non-axisymmetric. So perturbations are also axisymmetric. This is the result. However, even in that result, they use somehow, in non-trivial way, they use numerical methods. So this result seems to be an exact result, but they use some numerical methods to prove it. I still didn't see a completely exact proof of this statement. And in our case, with cosmological constant, everything is less known. So we don't have uniqueness theorems for black holes, and still we don't know as much about also about possible existence of non-axisymmetric solutions. But this is a hard and open question. Does there exist a non-axisymmetric solution to that equation?
Okay, so are there other comments or questions?
Actually, I have one more question. How dimension dependent all of it is?
Up to here, it has been worked out in n dimensions, I believe, up to here.
Yeah, that is very nice that this equation 7 is true in every dimension, exactly the way it is written.
So in general, it would be n minus 2 dimensional, right? So I think this wouldn't hold true because
here we use topological invariants which work only for two-dimensional surfaces.
Yes, and here, well, I you could probably try to solve it in n minus two, but
I think that there are generalizations of this result to higher dimensions.
This is what I was asking about, if there are some results in different dimensions on axisymmetric black holes. For example, in 2 plus 1, is there some sort of uniqueness for BTZ? Do you know, perhaps?
That would be doable. So you mean going downwards with dimensions to go lower.
Yes, my guess would be that it should be easier.
Well, okay, so then it is much easier because here we have this notion of rotation, and the notion of rotation in one dimension less, it would not exists because every one form in one dimension is closed. So for this reason, we would have, it would be simpler. It would be simpler. So because but I don't know to what extent it simplifies. But certainly some discreteness. We would see some discreteness. This. I'm sure that one could sit down and probably solve this problem in a few hours in lower dimensional case, because then everything is, if you assume lower dimensional case, effectively it's the same as assuming axial symmetry, because all your equations are just ordinary differential equations. So assuming lower dimension is technically is very similar to assuming axial symmetry.
See, thank you.
So maybe it's if this problem is not solved, I'm sure that Pan.
Yeah, I don't know.
That Pan Eryk can today after lunch can solve it.
So maybe let us finish official part of the seminar. So I will stop recording and we can ask other questions after. Thank you. So thank you very much for the talk.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.